Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Theory of Bastards by Audrey Schulman. Narrated by Rachel Dulude. But sometimes a tool may have other uses that you don't know. Sometimes in doing what you intend, you also do what the knife intends without knowing. Philip Pullman. Day 1. Chapter 1. When Frankie's vehicle pulled in, she saw a whole group of them waiting for her, exactly what she hated. Dressed up, milling about, eager supplicants. 10 or 11 researchers in all, probably every PhD at the foundation. When the door slid open and she stepped out, they blinked. A few glanced back inside the vehicle to search for another passenger before returning to her. She didn't look much like her press photos these days. Dr. Bellows, the executive director, was more prepared. Perhaps he had heard rumors, or maybe her request for a wheelchair had been enough. He stepped forward to clasp her hands, saying how delighted, how truly honored he was to have her here. He'd read all her papers. The chair was pushed forward, and Frankie sank into it. The group of them made lots of noise, talking all around her, each adding their tidbit of information. The Foundation's illustrious history, the past researchers, the freedom and facilities she would have. Frankie barely had to say a word. They wheeled her along into a courtyard with a large catered meal. A woman stepped in front for a moment, framing the shot with her fingers, ready to take a photo, calling out, "Smile." "Jesus," Frankie said, and held her hand in the way. "Just take me to the animals. Let me see them. I haven't agreed to this job yet." The silence awkward, the apologies profuse. They moved her toward the exhibits. The crowds of tourists, pushing strollers and eating popcorn, parted like water in front of them. The exhibits were connected by a wandering path through landscaped gardens. They passed the gorilla and chimp enclosures. They did not even glance at them. The orangutans watched the parade go by, their jowly faces swiveling like radar dishes. This level of attention being paid to her was relatively new. She'd heard afterward that the MacArthur Committee was made up of very smart but busy experts. When asked to come up with names, they were likely to scan headlines, to quark some searches. The press about her last study had hit during the spring, probably when they were making nominations. Up until then, she'd mostly been underfunded and ignored. She wanted very much to return to that. The desire wasn't out of kindness, a wish to make others comfortable, no. 33 years old and fresh from this last surgery, she had no use for other people's jealousy. The doctors had been so careful in what they said, trying to be exact. 85% chance of recovery, not from her disease, just the symptoms. Still, she was so hungry for this opportunity. Waiting to see if the symptoms would return, there was the high-pitched hum of disbelief in her ears, like an extraterrestrial who'd finally cracked the door open, about to take that terrifying first breath. The medicine she craved was distraction. They arrived at the bonobo enclosure, the area blocked off from the tourists. Today, these animals were for her appreciation alone. Inside the plexiglass walls was a hill with a climbing structure on it and a small pond at the base of it, a few milk crates scattered about. Realizing something was up, the 14 bonobos were clustered near the glass, watching the path for whatever change was about to arrive, the crowd of them reminiscent of the researchers waiting for Frankie's car. In appearance, they looked like the chimps she'd passed, only the bonobos were a touch skinnier and less muscled. Their fur softer, their lips red. Their eyes thoughtful. Think of a video montage where a human turns into a wild beast. hair sprouting, brow slanting, jaw jutting. If the chimp is the final image, the bonobo is a second earlier. In front stood one bonobo. Her stance was not a chimp's. Bandy-legged as a cowboy with the barrel-shaped chest heaved up, her torso ready at any moment to fall back onto all fours. No, she stood as a human does, comfortably upright, legs straight, her face turned to the researchers as though they just called her name. And, unlike the rest of the bonobos, her body was balding and her head utterly hairless. Perhaps an autoimmune disease or the effect of aging. What little hair remained on her body was no longer thick enough to be called fur, closer perhaps to the sparseness of chest hair. She stood there, wiry and short, her skin the gray of putty, a naked Gandhi with jug ears staring into Frankie's eyes. Actually, all of the bonobos were looking at Frankie. Staring not at the whole group of researchers, but at Frankie, her face. As though they'd followed the coverage in the Wall Street Journal and New York Times, the upswing in genetic testing, the outings of public figures and past presidents, and were surprised to spot her here. It took Frankie a moment to realize the animals must know all the researchers who worked here. She was the only stranger. Studies had shown even a sheep could recognize up to 50 faces. Dr. Bellows began to speak, his voice awkward.
The particular, behavior you'd be researching, the behavior that bonobos are famous for, happens primarily before mealtimes.
As though making excuses for them, he continued.
The behavior is used to ease tensions, to calm down any conflict over the food. Would you like me to...
Feed him, she said. Bellows nodded, and a researcher obediently jogged off around the corner of the building. Frankie waited. The animals continued to study her, in their half circle, positioned as though she was about to lecture them or they about to interrogate her. She gestured with her chin at the bald bonobo's confident stance. She asked, Alpha female?
Yes, said Bellows. She runs the show. That's Mama.
Mama? Frankie asked, the rising lilt of her question making her sound like a needy child.
Mama,
answered Bellows, letting the word fall heavy like the name of a mafia don. From the silence around them, she guessed most of the researchers worked with other apes here at the Foundation and felt comfortable with what was about to happen. She pointed her chin at the kiosk next to Bellows. It displayed a large photo of a bonobo waving high. There was a panel with many buttons on it. She asked, What's that? He said,
Some of the bonobos were raised with sign language. This is a way to communicate with them.
Really? Asked Frankie. Seated, she couldn't see which two buttons he pressed, but the avatar of a female bonobo appeared on the plexiglass between the humans and the bonobos, off to the side and a few feet up, so she didn't block the exhibit. Her hands gestured in sign language as she spoke the words saying, Human, hello. Her voice was loud, the condescending cheer of a kindergarten teacher. The bonobos didn't glance at the avatar. Instead, their dark eyes turned to Bellows. Then behind them, a door opened up on the balcony, inside the enclosure, and a staff person in coveralls stepped out, lugging two buckets of food. The bonobos turned, mouths gaping at their unscheduled luck. The males rose to their feet, legs apart to show off their abrupt erections, pencil thin but impressive. The moment following was when Frankie watched with the greatest attention. Just as she'd been told, all the animals reached for each other, for whoever was closest. Not one of them stepped around another to get to a preferred partner. Frankie's eyes watered with gratitude. She blinked a few times, keeping her face turned toward the animals, hoping no one could see. Here was the distraction she needed, a worthwhile puzzle to dig into. Meanwhile, the rest happened. The part that the media was fascinated with. The wide variety of acts and positions, homosexual and hetero, the twosomes, the threesomes, the sheer creativity, oral sex, a hand job, and what primatologists called penis fencing. An imaginative juvenile began to hump the leg of an otherwise occupied adult. Dwarf hairy humans engaged in an orgy. A researcher giggled nervously. Bello's head swiveled and the giggle stopped. Within seconds, the first bonobo began to climax.
Ah,
the female huffed loudly.
Ah.
Damn, whispered a woman under her breath somewhere behind Frankie, impressed either with the speed with which the bonobo had reached this point or its obvious intensity. Then the rest of the females began to call,
ah,
their mouths open. The male's orgasms were less noisy and sounded a trifle disappointed in comparison. The action stopped. They lay there, post-orgasm, arms wrapped tenderly around each other. After a long, quiet moment, one of them remembered the food and stood up. The rest followed, holding their hands out, palms up, like beggars. On the balcony, the staff person was waiting. She picked fruit out of the buckets and began to lob pieces down to them. "Well," said Bellows, trying to recover his toothy smile. For the first time since seeing the bonobos, Frankie turned to the humans. She said, "Let me confirm some facts. They do this before every meal?"
"Yes," said Bellows.
"Just that way? Copulating with whomever is closest?"
"Yes."
"Then, so far as any of you know," said Frankie, raising her voice slightly to make sure they could all hear, "it's just as likely that an ovulating female will end up mating with the least healthy male as the most healthy one? She is just as likely to mate with the weakest and dumbest as the strongest and smartest?"
"Yes,"
responded the group. "All righty," said Frankie. "I officially accept the research position here. I have three conditions." "One," she said, "I want an apartment on the foundation grounds with its own kitchen." "Two," she said, "you can write as many grants as you want using my name and resume, and I hope lots of funding comes from those grants. But understand my reason for being here is to do research. I will not be trotted out to wine and dine any potential funders. I will not be bothered or contacted unnecessarily. If I am, I will leave." "Three," she added, "I require the help of one researcher part-time, someone to answer questions about the bonobos and assist me as needed."
Of course," said Bellows. "May I recommend..."
He started to gesture toward a tall, bearded man. Frankie recognized him from several of the Foundation brochures and conference pamphlets. The man had been eyeing her since she arrived, possessive and hungry, like a dog watching a biscuit. "No," Frankie said, and pointed instead to the only person she could see who wasn't directly facing her, some guy who had hung back the whole time, looking like he wanted to be someplace else, probably doing his work. Pretty much the way she felt. "Him," she said. Day 2. Chapter 2. At 8 the next morning, the researcher she'd selected met her in the parking lot in front of the Bonobo Research Building. The way she looked today, she could star as the villain in a sci-fi movie. Wheelchair, stretchy clothing, and cavernous stare. He, on the other hand, could play one of the Secret Service men standing in the background of any movie with the president. Buzz cut, white teeth, and a rangy ease that said he could lope without effort for days. Unlike most people, no bindi glittered on his forehead, displaying its corporate logo. Instead, he wore just an old wristable. She hadn't realized they still made them, the device as bulky as a watch. She wondered if his salary was that low. He stepped forward to shake her hand, his smile wide,
his hand warm. Probably not the sharpest knife in the drawer, she thought.
David Stotts, he said. It's an honor to meet you, ma'am.
I don't like praise, she said. Don't give me any. He paused, considering her words, and nodded. He said, sorry about that.
From the way he said this, she wasn't sure if he was apologizing for his words or just sad she couldn't appreciate praise. She continued,
here's how your work with me is going to go. You'll assist me a little each day, help me get around, teach me about the bonobos. It won't take much of your day, and the amount will decrease gradually. You'll still be able to do your own research. I will not waste your time.
At the moment, in her bag was a jar of mayonnaise. Her meals the last few days consisted of a heaping spoonful of it. For a decade, she had not been allowed this condiment, all the eggs and that oil. It was the richest joy in the mouth, the thrill of the forbidden. She licked it like ice cream, the mathematical accumulation of calories, no need to even chew. Years ago, she'd started dressing for herself, no one else. Currently, she wore the sort of primary-colored smock and sparkly tights that suggested a child under 5. Her favorites were clothes with embroidered animals on the breast and along the hem. It was her habit, when concentrating, to run her fingers over the grinning animals, feeling the smooth threads. He wore a crisp button-down shirt and chinos, a uniform of anonymity. His eyes lingered on a bright yellow chicken on her left breast. The foundation had spent the last 2 months wooing her, trying to persuade her to do research here. Actual paper brochures FedExed daily, links to pertinent research papers and videos. Bellows left personal pleas on her SIM mail. They'd never received a word back until 2 days ago, when she'd quirked to say she would arrive the next morning. No more notice than that. The chicken had its beak open. Its little sound bubble said, cheap.
Ma'am, he said, you clearly like to get to the point. Dr. Bellows asked me to say I might not be the best person for this job. I have only been working with the bonobos for 6 months, and they are not what my degree is in.
His voice wasn't purposeful and clipped like hers, a New Yorker cutting through traffic. The rhythm of his words ambled along instead, a rural Missouri road, no car in sight.
Don't care, she said. If I require information you don't know, you'll learn it.
No reaction visible on his face. Again, he nodded.
Good, she thought. He won't be a problem.
She said, bring me to the bonobos. Do the research you normally do. I'll watch and occasionally ask questions.
Yes, ma'am.
He stepped forward to push her wheelchair. Army? She asked.
Ma'am?
You keep calling me ma'am. Were you in the army, or is this some sort of regional verbal tic?
The reserves, he said. That's how I paid for school. I served in Syria.
You served remotely?
No, I actually went there.
How many years?
4. Called up twice.
She said, hopefully working with me will be easier. She meant this as a small joke. He made no comment. He wheeled her into the research building attached to the bonobo enclosure. Inside, it looked like any office hallway. White walls and gray carpet, offices on either side. 30 feet down the hall was a second door with locks on it. A bright sign declaring no admittance to unauthorized personnel. Entering this hallway, she gestured for him to halt, and she got up out of the wheelchair. He was getting used to the rhythm of their interaction, his pause a bit shorter.
Ma'am?
She said. I have to walk a little further each day. The wheelchair is just for a few days.
He looked at her and then down the hallway, his unstated question clear.
If I need to, I'll sit down, she said.
She inhaled through her nose and began to shuffle forward. He walked alongside her, ready to catch her if necessary. He reduced his speed once to try to match her pace, and then reduced it further. With that lanky body, he must engage in some marathon sport.
running, biking, swimming. It took concentration for him to move this slowly, like watching a racehorse being walked to the gate. He looked down at his feet, might have been counting between each step. Since the award, colleagues treated her differently. Some avoided her as much as possible, and when they couldn't, they seemed on edge, as though she'd just insulted them or questioned their credentials. Others focused on her, like she'd said something profound even when she hadn't spoken. For this, her medical sabbatical, she'd been imagining Nepal, or better yet, Fiji, someplace far from everyone she knew, where she could retreat into insignificance, concentrate on work. There were, however, so many travel advisories, and they changed quickly. A few days ago, she decided Missouri was good enough. Compared to New York City, it was a foreign country. Republican, rural, creationist, poor. Partway down the hall was a machine. It was colored brightly and looked a bit like the type of strength test found at a country fair, except displayed as its metric were various primate silhouettes, from a bush baby all the way up to a mountain gorilla. Instead of a target to be hit with a mallet, there was a hand grip to squeeze. "Explain," she said. He looked at her and then the machine. He said, "It's a way of comparing your strength to other primates. No need to try it." The hand grip was similar to the hand strengthening equipment that ex-jocks squeezed while talking on the phone. She had a hard time bypassing any challenge. Also, her feet felt a little far away. The idea of grabbing onto something solid was attractive. Stopping, she wrapped her fingers round its molded grip, inhaled and compressed the spring as hard as she could. Determination was a quality she did not lack. She watched the needle swing upwards from bush baby to tarsier and past tamarin. It stopped at ring-tailed lemur. Average weight, 5 pounds. They both looked at the result, neither saying anything. She let her hand fall to her side. She asked, "How much do the bonobos weigh?"
"The females?" he said. "About 70 pounds.
She turned to him, and at her expression, he stepped forward, took hold of the hand grip, and squeezed. She could see the effort rising into his shoulder. Being in the military left its impact on a person's posture and attitude. Stotts would stand out in a crowd like a fox in a group of Pekingese, alert, coiled, and capable. There was the sense he wouldn't slouch on the sofa watching a movie, unaware of what was happening behind him. He could not do less than his best. The needle stopped at macaque, average weight, 25 pounds. Rather than look upset, his eyes were pleased. He said, proud,
"Once I made it all the way to Mandrill."
She glanced at his left hand, saw the wedding ring. "You have kids?" she asked. He turned to her.
"The sweetest 4-year-old on the planet. Why?"
She said, "Seemed like you should." Given her well-known research, comments about reproduction could be taken many ways. He filed this statement away for consideration and gestured to the machine.
"Humans," he said, "have a fair amount of muscle fiber, but we're like..."
He paused, thinking.
"We're like a bank account, where you can't take all the cash out in one day. The other primates can, or at least that's the current theory. Why you hear of chimps being able to rip a human's arm off. What they're doing is withdrawing all their money. Occasionally you hear of a human exhibiting sudden strength, a mom lifting a car off her kid, but it's rare."
He said,
"For other apes, it's automatic. They can do it any day of the week, just afterwards they're very tired."
The word, tired, echoed in her ears, and she touched her fingers to her sternum, feeling her breath. He watched her. When he spoke again, his voice was quieter. Perhaps he thought she felt fear. He said,
"Bonobos are different from chimps. They don't go to war with rival groups. They've never been recorded to kill. Even when they struggle for dominance inside their own group, there's almost no violence, just a lot of yelling and slapping things around. Worst I've ever seen was a male getting bit. 3 drops of blood, and they were all so surprised.
Every one of them came over to inspect the cut several times. Stotts, the ex-soldier, said with respect,
"They are the most gentle creatures."
The locked door was now perhaps 15 feet away. She swung her foot forward, aiming for it. When she spoke, her voice echoed in her head as though from another room.
"Why were you pleased with the results?"
"The results," she said.
"The strength test."
"Ah," he said.
He looked at the door ahead and answered,
"Ma'am, I like challenges. I am twice the size of the bonobos and I'm strong for a human, yet even the smallest female could beat me up. I respect these apes. They keep me awake."
He continued,
"Every day I try that machine and I never get close to their strength."
Even as slowly as he walked, he was now half a pace ahead. While he considered how to make this point clear, momentarily inattentive of her progress or pallor.
He said, "We keep them caged here, but they aren't like lab rats where we can force them to do what we want. They are smart and very strong. We have to ask to persuade. In the enclosure and research room, the rules aren't made by humans or bonobos. Instead, they're somewhere in between, some compromise we all constantly negotiate."
At the word negotiate, the static rose, engulfing her hearing. Her vision tunneled. She had practice at this, had already let her knees go, was falling with some control. She sat down hard on the floor. Her gut and the incision jarred. A harsh light, sound whistling, space empty. This type of pain, she didn't mind that much. It didn't last. She leaned into the light and waited it out. From some faraway universe, he called,
"Dr. Burk, you're fainting. Put your head down." She thought, no duh.
She felt him place one hand on the back of her head, folding her over, his other arm wrapped around her. Shivering, she could feel his warmth through her shirt. Chapter 3. Frankie had been born in Hamilton, Ontario, and baptized Francine Burk. Francine was the name she went by until after college. Her parents, Canadians, didn't discuss politics, sex, or bowel movements. Their voices were carefully modulated, every consonant clear as a bell. They took a brisk walk once a day and ate a well-cooked vegetable with dinner. As Protestants, they considered a visit to the doctor somewhat suspect, a lack of fortitude. Their only medicine was an occasional aspirin taken with a glass of water, preferably out of sight of anyone except an observant child. When asked, they always replied they were doing well, thank you. In Hamilton, they blended in seamlessly with their neighbors. Perhaps that was the point. When she was 7, however, her father took a job with an American company and they moved to Manhattan. The cultural change was surprisingly large. The word please was not half as common. Strangers voiced their opinions with gusto. She remembered a dinner party early on, where her father was seated beside aged Mr. Schwartz, who, when asked how he was, began describing his prolapsed hernia. Both of her parents strove to keep whatever feelings they felt within the range of what they considered allowable. Within this narrow range, her father's expression was as shocked as if Mr. Schwartz had fondled himself at the table. She was enrolled in the 2nd grade at PS 116 in Midtown. First thing that day, the whole class got to its feet, placed hands on hearts, and recited the Pledge of Allegiance in one voice. She wasn't quite sure how she should act, and so stood by her desk, her head lowered as though she were in church. Basically, she was baffled.
No one in Ontario ever pledged allegiance to anything, and they were asked to sing O Canada so infrequently that, after the first stanza, most had to resort to indistinct humming. She waited until recess to approach her new teacher, Miss Sanchez. In her crisp Ontario voice, Francine explained she was a citizen of another country and inquired what was the proper way to act while the rest of the class repeated the pledge. "Put your hand on your heart and say the pledge," said the teacher while putting her papers away. Francine repeated for clarity, "But I'm Canadian." As fast as that, Sanchez's eyes flashed. She leaned in and stated in a no-nonsense adult voice that so long as Francine was lucky enough to be in this great country, she would recite the pledge each morning and be grateful for the opportunity. Later, Francine learned Sanchez's youngest brother had recently lost a leg in Iraq. Although easily a third of the students in the class were not citizens, every one of them was forced to pledge allegiance daily. That afternoon, it was Gerard from Haiti who taught Francine the preferred coping strategy. From then on, she recited each morning along with the class, her hand over her heart, "I led the pigeons to the flag." This was her first lesson in the utility of lying. After Frankie recovered from half-fainting, she had Stotts wheel her to the tourists' area in front of the bonobo enclosure and leave her there. It had the best view of the animals, and she could rest. She sat there, watching with attention. In order to see around the hips and elbows of the people, she rolled forward until her knees were pressed against the glass. In the first few minutes, a six-year-old girl tried to wiggle between Frankie's knees and the glass to get a better view of the bonobos. Frankie kneed her in the back just hard enough for the girl to regard her solemnly and then retreat. A lot of the children ignored the bonobos in order to play with the sign language kiosk. Whoever designed it had intended one person to press one button at a time, carefully building each sentence. "Me human, look, stick, stick on ground." Perhaps the designer had even imagined the bonobos responding by picking the stick up or signing back. A moment of interspecies communication. Instead, however, the children clustered around the kiosk, slapping at the buttons, thrilled by the obedient toy, making the bonobo avatar on the plexiglass say sentences like, "Stick, stick, 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 human, 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 stick, 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 ground." The voice was loud, even outside the enclosure. The bonobos ignored the avatar, aside from staying away from the immediate area near the speakers. Frankie figured she could start working. She said, "Okay, Bindi, show desktop." On her contact lenses appeared her desktop icons, arrayed around the periphery of her visual field, allowing her to still see the physical world in front of her. Applications on the left, files on the right, the trash can in the corner. Moving her right hand up so her Bindi could track it, she centered her index finger over the file for the 14 bonobos and double-tapped. The file opened up, centered in her vision. Her Bindi, at this point, monitored the area around her for any objects headed for her, clicking her desktop off in case of danger. Too many cases those first few years of people stepping out in front of a moving car while on a SIM call. She flicked her finger through the pages. She wasn't self-conscious because half the adults around her were tapping and flicking and talking to their Bindis. The photo for each bonobo had a passing resemblance to a mugshot, a close-up of the face with the name and description below, "Hairy Perpetrators in Jail." If she clicked on a photo and tugged on its corners, the photo expanded. So large and high res, she could see every skin pore. Unaided, she'd never be able to keep a face this close and in focus at the same time. The colors also popped. The brown of the eyes, the gray of the face, the pink of the lips. The problem Frankie found was, after a day of work on her lenses, reality appeared a little disappointing. In comparison to their photos, the bonobos themselves seemed less real. And her lenses weren't even the newest version. Technology had now reached the limits of human vision. Soon, she'd been told, the lenses would bypass the eyes to connect straight to the visual cortex. One by one, she stared at each photo, then pinched her fingers together, shrinking the photo down and flicking it up to the top of her lenses, out of the way, so she could search for the bonobo who matched the photo. Mama was easy to recognize because she was bald. Frankie assumed the juvenile who Mama held was Tooch, a 2-year-old male, since he was listed as her youngest offspring. Tooch kept trying to sneak closer to the plexiglass, fascinated by the tourists. Mama stopped him each time, pursing her lips and making a noise in her throat that made him halt mid-stride. The fifth time he tried to sneak away, she simply picked him up by one foot and dangled him out in the air like a fish. Tooch squealed and wiggled and tried to climb his own leg, but soon gave up, hanging there limp, waiting for her to put him down. She lowered him into her lap where he sat, staring at the tourists with a wistful expression. Mama was not a mother to trifle with. Of all the bonobos, the only one younger than Tooch was Id, a 1-year-old female. She was easy to spot since she was tiny, all pencil-thin limbs, wispy fur, and large eyes. She was bouncing maniacally on the trampoline of her mother's belly. From the document, Frankie learned the mother's name was Houdina. Her knees jumped involuntarily each time the baby Id landed. In comparison to Mama, Houdina was younger and hairier and didn't seem to be half as tough. She grunted with each bounce and held up her hands, protecting her tender areas. Frankie tried to identify the other bonobos from their photos, but couldn't. They all looked like hairy apes to her at this point. The only feature she could easily distinguish was gender, since the nether regions were large and hairless and disturbingly on display. For most of the adult females, the area between the vagina and anus were hairless and swollen into something between a softball and cantaloupe, advertising their potential fertility to all nearby males. The skin over this balloon appeared so tight and thin that each time the female sat down, Frankie flinched. After a while, she gave up trying to tell which individual was which. She let herself watch them as a group, absorbing their actions, getting the feel for them, their bright eyes, their knuckled walk, the way they bathed in the pond, lying back in the water and letting their arms float, squirting water out of their mouths. Their voices reminded her of the finches she used to work with, high-pitched cheeps or squeaks. They spent an enormous amount of time combing their fingers through each other's hair, bored hairstylists on a slow day, the face of the groomed bonobo slack with pleasure. Even though Mama had little hair, she was groomed the most. The others would approach her to clap their hands in front of her, requesting the honor. If she accepted, she would offer them part of her body. After finishing, the groomer would sometimes crouch low with pouting lips. If Mama felt generous, she would tilt her chin up and close her eyes so the groomer could give her a wet kiss on the chin. The scene reminded Frankie of a royal court, an inbred hive of shifting alliances, the lesser nobility approaching the queen with gifts. Every once in a while, the juveniles played what looked like tag, barreling after each other on all fours, a breathless charge, a blistering speed that didn't change at all, even when the chase switched from running across the ground to bolting 30 feet straight up the side of the metal climbing structure. The athleticism was impressive, since they weren't tiny like squirrel monkeys, but had real heft. The slaps of their palms on the metal audible even through the plexiglass. Anytime more than one of the bonobos disappeared behind the concrete hill on the far side of the enclosure, Frankie would say, "Okay, Bendy," and with a few brisk gestures, enlarge and center on her lenses the video feed from the foundation cameras on the other side of the hill. Considering the standards for video these days, the feed was remarkably grainy, intended only for the researchers working on the foundation. However, at least this way, she could watch the hidden bonobos to make sure she didn't miss a mating or other interesting behavior. After she'd spent a few hours watching the bonobos, someone jostled Frankie's wheelchair, and she turned in irritation to the tourists behind her. For a moment, she paused, surprised by her own species. It was like turning from a broadcast about Olympic gymnasts to look at the viewers sprawled on the couch. Of course, current events were partly to blame. The drought in California and across the southern U.S. still hadn't broken, and the escalating violence in the Middle East had doubled prices for petroleum. Prices for everything had skyrocketed. These days, a lot of Americans were relying on Fritos and soda while working overtime at whatever jobs they could find. The bonobos, on the other hand, ate almost entirely fresh fruit flown in from the tropics. The cost of the fruit, along with vet bills, was the primary reason Frankie was here. With her recent award and publicity, the foundation could attract more grants. Her award exchanged for mangoes and medicine. These days, everyone did whatever was needed in order to cope. An hour before closing time, the bonobos became restless, crowding into the area in front of the balcony, competing for the best spot, staring upward, waiting. Irritated with all the pushing, Mama grabbed one of the milk crates and slammed it on the ground. Whack! She dragged it behind her as she galloped around, the rattle of it along the ground impressive, Tooch on her shoulder, faced into the wind like a jockey. The bonobos quieted and cleared a wide space for her. She knuckled forward into the space, assuming her position in the front. Then the keeper stepped out onto the balcony with the food, the same woman who'd fed them before, wearing foundation coveralls. The male bonobos stood up, knees apart, to display their sudden erections, skinny and pink and pointing straight up. The bonobos began mounting each other, businesslike as salesmen shaking hands. Id, standing on her mother's back, jounced around by all the action, occasionally reached down with curiosity to finger one pink area or another. And the tourists fled, the stroller wheels wobbling with the speed, the parents singing out promises to their children about the snack shack and popsicles. A few older children remained for a moment, staring, before running after the adults, calling out questions. Frankie leaned forward, intent. In a few days, once she had learned all the names of the bonobos, she would start keeping notes about each mating, checking that the choice of sexual partner was truly random. If it was, she would design a study investigating how the species continued to breed healthy offspring. One of the most basic tenets of evolution was that there must be strong mating criteria, that a bonobo would step past whoever was closest to copulate with another who was healthier or smarter or stronger. However, from what she'd seen so far, these bonobos weren't even particular about gender. Afterward, post-orgasmic and calm, none of the bonobos had any interest in fighting for the food. Instead, they simply held out their hands, palm up, their fingers flexing in an instinctive bonobo give-me gesture. The keeper lobbed chunks of fruit down to them, which they caught with one hand. They did not gobble this food like dogs bolting down canned mush. Instead, they delicately peeled back the skin and picked out the seeds before taking a bite that they rolled around in their mouths like wine, eyes closed, inhaling with joy. When the keeper had thrown the last of the fruit, she held the buckets out so the bonobos could see they were empty. Most of the bonobos began looking around for any pieces that might have been dropped. Mama, however, continued to stand, her hand out, her fingers flexing, asking for something more. Tooch, against her chest, supplicated also with his tiny palm. The keeper reached for an object by her feet and looked at Mama, waiting. In response, Mama didn't repeat the bonobo gesture, but made a different one. She held her left palm up, flat as a table, then reached out with the other hand, wrapping her fingers around an invisible object on the table and raising it into the air. The gesture precise. Frankie blinked. The avatar spoke, translating the American Sign Language gesture. The voice was clear, each consonant enunciated, a human voice emerging from the image of a bonobo's face. The avatar said, "Bottle." The keeper nodded and tossed the object in her hand, a baby bottle. Mama caught it with the ease of an outfielder and handed it to Tooch. He took the bottle with both hands, rolled onto his back, and started nursing. For the first time, Frankie noticed Mama's breasts were flat. Like any mother, Mama was happy for a moment, simply watching her baby drink, sucking in strength. Then lazily, she touched her fingers to her lips, extending her palm toward the keeper. If Frankie hadn't seen the other sign, she might not have recognized this as language. The avatar translated the gesture automatically. "Thank you." Mama's hands were large and hairy and scarred from knuckle walking. She scratched her butt with one of them, then picked up a chunk of pineapple from her pile of food and began to eat. Day 3, Chapter 4. The next morning, Frankie and Stotts tried again. She managed to walk most of the hallway, nearly reaching the locked door, powering forward, the little engine that could. Then she paused and reached a hand out in the direction of the wall. He needed no other clue. He scooped her up, sat her down on the floor, and folded her over like a lounge chair. Facing the ground from just a few inches away, it looked so much less threatening than it had a moment ago. He sat down beside her, one hand on her back. He relaxed, stretching out his legs, as though he was sitting on his favorite couch, like they were an old married couple watching the news. In Syria, he'd probably seen the carnage resulting from suicide bombers and IEDs, automatic weapons used on school buses. Perhaps, like the NYPD, nothing could flummox him. Unlike her, he was the kind of person who could touch others easily. He was used to assisting and did so without effort. He said, "Ma'am, you seem to like this hall." She stared at the ground, blinking. He asked, "Anything you want to tell me about your medical condition?" She did her best to say, "Endometriosis." There was a lot more air to the word than sound. She inhaled and tried again. "Stage 4, surgery, recovering." Those 5 words had so much packed into them, a medical haiku. She always learned about people from their reactions, not so much what they knew about endometriosis as what the depth of their experience was with disease in general. Basically, their reactions could be taken as a rough proxy for how many people they loved and with how much courage, grandparents, spouses, friends. Some people's eyes skittered or got flat. Others said, "I'm sorry," a little loudly as though for someone else's benefit. Their responses left her spotlit and alone. Stotts, he stayed there with her, his hand warm on her back. He said, "Tell me what you need and I'll help." Such a simple statement. He looked around and offered, "My office has a couch. Would you like to rest there?" She said, "No." He offered,
I could bring some other researchers here. You could ask questions.
No, she said, and pushed herself up to lean back against the wall.
Take me to see the research.
He examined her expression. She said, let me see your work. It's the best medicine. He took his hand off her back, but made no motion to get up. She began to pat the ground around her. The difficulty of climbing to her feet might be overcome, she felt, if she could just get the placement of her hands right.
He said, no need to rush. Tell me about the birds. How do you come up with the idea of putting hats on them?
Surprised, she said, Bellows made you read my grad school thesis?
Stotts nodded. Every one of your papers, and then he quizzed me. Why the hats?
She could remember the zebra finches so clearly. Their fluttering flight. The male's complicated mating call. Stravinsky on a squeaky toy. As a species, they were not beautiful. Their markings didn't work together like a tiger's or a puffin's. Instead, they had a mishmash of possible motifs. A few stripes here, a speckled corner there, the tuxedo front. Evolutionarily, they hadn't finished getting dressed, but paused in front of the mirror, unsure of which statement to make. She said, I looked at the finches. It seemed clear what they were missing.
What did the other students think about what you were doing?
She said, no one cared. I was a nobody. It was lovely. For a lab space, she'd been assigned what at one point had been a closet, 7 feet by 6, no window, forced to consider only small species. Her budget so restricted, she'd skipped the lab animal catalog and visited the pet store instead. Her advisor had signed all her papers while on the phone. The first time he truly focused on her was at the end of the year, when he reviewed her abstract, scanning it absentmindedly, then pausing to read it again with a tightness of attention. She led him to her closet to stare at the costumed birds and their pairings. Stotts asked,
how do you get the hats to stay on?
They weren't hats, she said. Just red nylon fluff. I used a hot glue gun to connect the fluff to their existing feathers, the same way hair extensions are added. The idea came to me while I was getting a haircut one day. He tucked his chin in.
People use hot glue on their heads?
Oh, what the female will do, she answered. Darwin in action. I found a color that matched the bird's beaks. Took me a while to master the technique. The fluff stood up like a crest. The newspapers were the ones to call it a top hat.
How long did the hats last?
Long enough for me to see the results on courtship and parenting.
And you put stockings on them too?
She exhaled. You're trying to stall, so I don't stand up and faint.
Yep, he said.
She folded her legs up to her chest and rested her forehead on her knees, breathing in the heat of her body. The darkness comforting. The world, she thought, would be a better place filled with the bluntness of Missouri men. What's your field? She asked, her voice muffled by her thighs.
Archaeology with a specialty in lithic technology.
Lithic what?
I specialize in tools from the Stone Age and how they were constructed.
It took her a moment before she responded. You're an expert in rocks?
Yes, ma'am.
She pulled her head up. The government paid for that?
Even these days, ma'am, no politician can argue with a military scholarship.
She grunted. Look, I'm ready to get up.
Your skin is the color of oatmeal.
It's my natural color.
You're using the wheelchair.
No, I'm not.
Yes, ma'am, you are,
he said, and rose to his feet, as easily, it seemed to her, as a ball bounces upward. He strode down the hall to retrieve the wheelchair. I don't need it, she said as she attempted to stand. She made it only part way before she stopped, her eyes watering. He returned with the chair and helped her up, not as a man helps his beloved, clasping her hands in his, but the way he would assist his grandma, his hands wrapped firmly around her upper arms. He lowered her into the seat. just 33 years old, and these days, men touched her with as little thought as they would a child or a piece of furniture. In the seat, she gave up and sat back. She said, "After this, I'd like to lie down on that couch." He answered,
"First smart thing you've said."
The word smart was ever so slightly emphasized. With a MacArthur comes a certain amount of teasing. His humor wasn't clipped and pushy, no New York cut of a fast-talking knife. Nor was it what she had imagined as Midwestern wit, knee-slapping guffaws, as intellectual as euchre. The door had several large and complicated locks on it. A screen beside it declared entry denied. "Why all these locks?" she asked. He said,
"One of the bonobos, Houdina, is a bit of an escape artist. For a while, we had to keep trying out new systems."
Frankie said, "She's the mom with the baby id."
"That's her," he said. "Most times, we had no idea how she did it. We caught her on video once, back when we were experimenting with metal keys. One of the observation cameras happened to be pointed straight at her. In the video, you see her lying in the sun, looking innocent, while the last human leaves for the night. She waits 2 minutes, then spits a researcher's key out of her mouth and heads straight for the door to open it. The others follow."
"How'd she get the keys?"
"When you're in the enclosure, they constantly groom you. Given all that touching, picking your pocket is easy."
Frankie asked, "When they get out, are they dangerous?" He snorted.
"They wander around the foundation, staring at the gorillas and orangutans and eating marigolds out of the flower beds. Adele heads to the basketball court by the parking lot, does free throws for hours. The family that raised her used to play basketball with her. Goliath goes to the kitchen. He drinks dishwashing soap so he can burp bubbles. The female bonobos love that, but it gives the vets conniptions."
He said,
"With the locks now, we're using speech recognition combined with scanning the person's bodywear. You need to check in with the office later to make sure your ID is in the security system."
He said,
"Okay, door, open."
He turned to her and added, "The bonobos can't talk, not yet." The screen flashed green. The lock clicked, and Stott swung the door open. Chapter 5. A month after her 11th birthday, Francine stayed home from school with an ache in her gut. She was surprised because she rarely got sick. Since her parents never complained of being ill, she'd had the impression that health was partly a question of will. Working from home that day, her mom checked regularly on her daughter, taking her temperature and making sure she was hydrated. Francine's childhood memories of her mom were of her always facing Francine, her eyes warm. She called Francine the Marvel for her love of Marvel comic books and the fact that she'd been born at all. Although Francine's parents had tried a long time, they'd had no other children. Through the morning, the ache gradually increased, began to radiate down Francine's left leg. Mid-morning, she realized she had to pee, the need abruptly urgent. She stumbled to the bathroom and shoved down her pants. A person spends a life making the same actions each day. The actions seem simple, but are made up of millions of complex biological processes. Protein uptake, glucose levels, phagocyte function, walking down the stairs, picking up the newspaper, breathing. At some point, one of these processes goes wrong and the machine of the body stumbles. As she clenched her bladder, she felt something tug that shouldn't, a fleshy pull, a sharp pain. "Yow!" she yelled. Her mom moved fast down the hall to her, calling questions even before she got there. When she stepped into the bathroom, she saw the blood on Francine's underwear. She stopped, standing there. "Oh," said her mom, looking. And for a moment, her face held nothing at all. All humanity wiped from it, that distance appearing for the first time. "Oh," she said, "it's that." Inside the interaction area, behind the locked door, there was no more drywall or ceiling tile. Instead, it was all durable, cleanable surfaces, concrete, plexiglass, and steel. Along the hallway stood the woman who normally fed the bonobos. This woman, the keeper, was putting cleaning solutions away on a cart. She was faced away and had eardrums pumping out music so loudly Frankie could hear the papery beat from a distance of several feet. Her short permed hair, combined with her general thickness, made her look a bit like a Ukrainian shot putter, the power in her upper body waiting to be used. To warn her of their approach, Stotts leaned forward and waved his hand where she could see it. The keeper jerked around to face them. She turned, not in a startled, girly way, but more like a gun turret. Her eyes wide and dilated, her expression fixed, ready to battle. Her meaty hands held out. Then she recognized Stotts. She blinked and rolled her cart to the side for them to pass. Stotts nodded his thanks and wheeled Frankie forward. Frankie raised a palm in greeting. The keeper made no response, eyeing her. Moving down the hall, Stotts said, "She's deaf. Because of that, she's been in some scary situations. Make sure never to sneak up on her." Frankie said, "Deaf? As in deaf deaf?" "Yes, ma'am." "No hearing implant?" "No." "Why not?" "Never asked," he said. "She copes by always playing music loud enough that strangers will realize she can't hear them. Her version of a blind man's stick." Frankie considered this, looking back at the keeper. She asked, "What did you mean by scary situations?" He said, "When people want to warn you about danger, they do it through sound. A car's honk, a fire alarm, someone yelling, 'Heads up!' People expect sound to be enough, especially these days. She's had some surprises." She grunted. "She was hired because she knows sign?" "Yep," he said. "Most of the staff know fewer than 30 signs. She's the only one who's bilingual. Also, she's great with the apes. She doesn't take any guff, not even from the chimps." Stopping in the kitchen, Stotts opened a cupboard and took some food out. He said, "Okay, kitchen, I'm grabbing a banana and a bag of gummy bears." The fridge beeped and said, "Thanks, David. I've logged those items." Frankie asked, "Bellows charges for food?" He answered, "Everything I use, including electricity, is taken out of my budget." She said, "Electricity?" Stotts said, "It's a big cost these days, and he tries to be innovative. You don't have to worry. Your budget's ample." She listened for resentment around this statement, but he simply moved her down the hall to the next door and said, "Okay, door, open." The door clicked open, and he pushed her chair inside. He said, "Technically, the bonobos are allowed anywhere in this locked interaction area, but mostly we keep them here within the research room." The far side of the room had a large glass window into the enclosure. Light poured in, the nearest bonobos turning around to stare at them. Behind the bonobos was the cement hill and climbing structure, part of the pond visible. The hill lay between the tourists and researchers, blocking their vision of each other, allowing both groups to feel as though they were alone with the apes. Stotts parked her in the corner of the room next to the whiteboard. "Stay here," he said. "Once Goliath enters the room, don't talk and don't get out of the chair. That's important." At Stotts's words, the upper torso of the bonobo avatar appeared on the wall next to the window. Her hands moved quickly and fluidly, translating his words into sign. Stotts said, "He will take a while to get used to you. We don't want to alarm him." Stotts's words flashed by under the avatar's face as she made each gesture. The speed so fast it was hard to match the word to the gesture. Still, the gestures were hypnotic. The impulse was to watch as though the motions would soon make sense, as though a language could be broken with a few minutes of concentration. "Why not?" Frankie asked. The avatar translator signed those two words as the text appeared below her chest. For the word not, she shook both her head and fist no. At least Frankie could translate this one word. Whoever had designed the avatar hadn't spent a lot of money on it. The nose was a bit pointed and the hands small for a bonobo, the gestures brisk and the expression businesslike. The overall feel was of a human dressed up in a bonobo costume, some makeup applied. He answered, "First off, ma'am, that'd be cruel. Secondly, while he's a gentle soul, it's wise to remember he has the physical power to rip our faces off our skulls. Third, to do research here, we need the cooperation of the bonobos." He suggested, "Think of him as your colleague. We're introducing you. Try to act polite and give a good first impression. If you need to communicate anything, write it out on the whiteboard." "Okay, door, open," he said, and opened the door into the enclosure. He called out, "Goliath, you want to come visit?" Frankie stared surprised through the door into the enclosure, the sense of open space, the smell of manure and fruit and cleaning products. The visible bonobos glanced over, nothing between them and her. "Goliath," Stotts called. A bonobo popped his head up over the edge of the hill, considering them. Stotts said, "That new researcher I told you about yesterday is here. You want to meet her?" The bonobo didn't move forward. "You told him about me?" Frankie asked. "Of course," he said. "We ask permission." He agreed when he heard you're a woman. All the bonobos prefer women. He turned back to Goliath and called, "I'll let you look through the new people." Goliath began to knuckle toward them. She asked, confused, "Look through the new people?" "People magazine." "No." "Oh, yes," said Stotts. "Goliath has a crush on Jade Pitt. Always looks for photos of her." "Jade who?" "The actress from that LA medical show."
"Really? How do you know?"
Stotts stepped away from the open door to empty his bag of all edibles, gummy bears and a banana, into a desk drawer. He closed and locked the drawer while he said, "Ma'am, bonobo love is not subtle." She blinked to get rid of the image in her head. Goliath was moving leisurely toward them, pausing occasionally to examine a milk crate or some food debris. His wandering path reminded her of the way a cat will approach to be petted, moseying along indirect enough not to lose self-respect. She asked, "How much English does he understand?" The avatar repeated her words in sign, her brow raised to a single question. Stotts looked to make sure Goliath was too far away to hear. He said, "Hard to know. Goliath was raised pretty much as a human child in an American family. He had his own bed, wore clothes, and drank tea. Raised with spoken English and sign. Then he grew up, got strong, and, well, sexual, and the family gave their child to us." Frankie looked at him, waiting for a better answer to her question. He said, "The language researchers don't want our anecdotes. They want randomized trials using sentences the bonobos have probably never heard before, no potential communication through gesture or glance. So they perform tests where they wear masks, sit motionless, and ask in spoken English for the bonobos to put the ball in the microwave or the rock on the shoe. And," Stotts shrugged, "if someone in a lab coat asks a human to do a task, the person will generally obey as well as they can. The bonobos, if they don't like the researcher or find the experiment boring, they'll walk away. I once saw a researcher ask Goliath to put a banana in his armpit, and he just stared at her."
"So what are the results?"
"Preschool."
"What?"
He said, "On average, for those like Goliath, who were raised with English, their comprehension is roughly equivalent to a 4-year-old's." Frankie blinked at Stotts, then turned back to Goliath, who was near the door. Compact as a gymnast, He ambled forward with a bear's rolling stride. He said, "And when they talk with us, using sign, their vocab is on par with that of a 3-year-old." Behind him, the avatar signed each of his words, her expression bland. Goliath entered the room, all curious eyes and shiny black fur, a boy morphed with a Labrador. Stotts put some equipment on the desk, a beat-up metal box, a thick rope, and some large rocks. He asked, "Can you shut the door, please?" Goliath didn't glance at the avatar's translation, but closed the door and turned the knob to latch it. He climbed onto the desk next to Stotts, the comfort between them apparent, and stared with interest at Frankie. He rested his hands on his knees. They were huge and weathered, substantially bigger than a human's hands, the knuckles so clearly hinges. She sat still in her chair. Sitting with a bonobo in the same room felt different from watching one through plexiglass. The lack of a barrier shifted everything. Stotts took a banana out of the drawer, showed it to Goliath, and placed it in the metal box. At the sight of food, Goliath got an erection. His penis, the color of a pencil eraser, was so narrow and long that even when erect, it drooped at the end. He looked Stotts in the eye while pouting, a hairy version of Marilyn Monroe's come-hither look. "Ma'am," Stotts explained, "bonobos reduce conflict through sex. In captivity, the main source of conflict is food. After a while, the males get conditioned to react this way." Frankie looked at the avatar, of course trying to pick out the gesture for sex, but the avatar signed too quickly. He closed the metal box with the banana in it and began to tie the box shut with the thick rope. Goliath's erection began to slump. "What about in the wild?" Frankie asked. Both Stotts and Goliath looked at her. Stotts said, "Perhaps I wasn't clear. Please don't talk around Goliath. He's not my pet. I can't control him." He continued, "To answer your question, in the wild, if they find a large fruit tree, they have sex before they eat. If they bump into a strange group of bonobos, both sides break large branches off trees and bellow, demonstrating how strong and tough they are. After that, the two groups mingle to have sex. Like with humans, sex calms everyone down."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.